You got new shoes.
I know. I got them for John and Teresa's wedding. They got married.
Ah. Oh.
And then Chicago New Year's Eve.
These are something blue.
Special, yeah.
Yeah, well, I put on the laces. They were white laces.
Oh.
Sort of.
Did we know that Drake was going to be a romantic? I mean, that was, I think, the biggest shock of this movie for me. Was after Douchebag being your coming out party, who knew you were such a softie?
Well, you know, I think Douchebag is actually a really soft movie in a way, at its core, but on the surface it's not, so I think it's always sort of been deep down there, for sure. Yeah.
Just your nature, you were always waiting to make the,
yeah,
the ultimate, well, romance?
Yeah, I think, you know, I don't think this is as soft as a movie as well, but I think there's, you know, both in there.
Do you think anybody will ever buy it?
You know, I hope so. We'll see. Who knows?
It could have happened 4 hours ago.
It could have happened 4 hours ago. Paramount could have bought the movie. Who knows?
The entire Paramount or the little Paramount? Or is there
Paramount?
Some parts
of Paramount?
Paramount. Paramount.
Yeah.
So that's like a big deal.
I
like
think
the DreamWorks
so.
Of Paramount now.
I'm excited. Paramount's distributing the movie. It's going to be awesome.
That's very exciting. Yeah. So are they giving you a marketing plan already? Or are they?
You know, it's already been released. It's in 17 countries right now.
So
it's
quick.
It's doing amazingly well. And the numbers are great. They're huge.
Very exciting. So your cast.
Yes.
Dynamic duo here.
My amazing, amazing cast. The movie is only good because of the cast.
Easily sold in the UK. Because of Felicity.
Yes. And it's it sold in the valley because of Anthem.
Or something.
Yeah.
That's right. Between the two of you, the UK is kind of all covered.
Yeah.
And then you can, you know, work your way from there.
Yeah. World domination.
That's what she wants. That's her goal in life.
Is that the goal in life? I mean, this is the Sundance of the world domination girls.
Well, I think we want as many people to see the film as possible.
So how did you get into it in the first place?
I read the script and I knew I had to play that role. It was just a small matter of getting the role when I knew because of its quality that so many other young actors would want it. So I knew I had to do something a little bit unusual in order to get Drake's attention. So so I shot the shower scene, I don't know if you remember from the film, in my own shower. And recreated it because I thought the key to her, to that character, was getting that moment right.
Mm.
And hopefully I got it right.
It's perfect. The scene in the movie is actually what she shot for her audition.
Yeah, that's it.
I just cut and pasted it into the movie because it was so perfect. It was ready to go.
Have you ever had anything like that show up on your doorstep before?
Absolutely not. I was overwhelmed and I immediately knew that she was Anna.
You didn't feel the urge to ask all the other actresses to do a shower scene?
Well, I did do that, but I never shot it.
Just for fun.
Yeah, yeah.
Why not?
Why not, exactly. Yeah. And Anton,
did you do a shower scene?
No, I just slept with a couple of people. Big deal.
You slept with the entire cast of Winter's Bone, I guess.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
You and John Hawks, that was a great scene. I saw that tape.
That was beautiful.
Really? So I lost my copy, that's just why I'm
asking. It's on the internet.
Oh, shit.
Like everything else.
Can I media fire? Just a little download?
Is the movie on the internet yet? I guess not.
I hope so.
Well, now it's been distributed worldwide.
Let's not bother with the distribution.
Yeah, no, let's, you know, as many
just put it on the internet. Yeah.
So was Anton somebody you chose, or was it?
Yeah, Anton's somebody I sort of just had in my head, you know, the whole time. And Jonathan Schwartz, our wonderful producer, knew Anton, and they were friends for about 5 years. And in talking about making this movie, Anton was absolutely always at the forefront of being Jacob.
So how long did you shoot for? How long was it going to shoot?
We shot for about 12 months. No, I'm just kidding. We shot for...
It was longer than Avatar.
It was ridiculous budget.
What are you doing on this thing?
We shot for about...
The CG was amazing.
Amazing.
It wasn't
amazing.
Really.
Yeah.
He was a hologram in the movie. Yeah, and she was too. They're not
we
really
still
there.
Are, actually.
Yeah. They're not here either.
I thought we were going to be frogs.
Yeah,
that was the whole. That's what we kept being told.
Yeah, so I was told by my editor.
It was like frog love.
Yes, that's what it was supposed to be—a movie about frogs.
That was the pitch. Frogs, two frogs meet, they fall in love. One's English. They're
one's
in school.
Not English frog.
Yeah, English frog.
Yeah.
You're the English frog.
Yeah,
I'm the American frog.
We should have for 5 weeks, actually.
So that's not such a bad. That's a.
No, it was nice. It was nice. Yeah, we shot. In Los Angeles for about 3.5 and then we were in London for about a week and a half.
And were you shooting just exteriors in London, or did you shoot all the interiors there?
We shot everything that takes place in London.
So how did you make that decision?
It's just such an integral part of the film, and the city itself is such an obstacle in the film, and we had to get there, and we had to be there, and we had to be in the city and feel it. So
did it cost a lot more to shoot?
Yes, the movie was very expensive. I think it was the right decision.
You shot at Felicity's apartment, and you shot at Anton's apartment.
yeah, that's the real place.
Yes.
Yeah. And that's really her shower.
Well, I mean, this is the thing, there is that feel that you are, one of the indie guys, and everything is bootstrap.
But
the movie certainly doesn't look bootstrap. It looks very beautiful and clean. I mean, is that something that's changed, or is it just a matter of having a little bit more money and a little bit more time and a little bit more?
Yeah, it's an interesting question. I feel like I wanted the movie to feel very sort of cinematic and planned and mm-hmm. structured in that sense, but also very off the cuff and improvisational and sort of stolen and voyeuristic. So I think the two worlds meshing together create sort of a unique style.
He's just a pervert is what it is.
That's
basically.
What it is.
He's a voyeur of the highest order.
Well, aren't all directors really?
Yeah.
It's pretty much the gig.
Yeah.
You're really like a writer-director, then you like make everybody, you're really like a puppet master. It's horrifying. So did the two of you have time to... It is horrifying.
It's terrible.
It is hideous. Did you guys have time to develop the relationship aside from shooting? I mean, did you guys meet on the set and start going, or did you have weeks of rehearsal?
We had 2 weeks of rehearsal. It was, I think, really important because... I feel like when you're doing improv, I feel like when we first got together, we just wanted to talk, and talk and fill space. And then you realize that the relationships are all about the things that you don't say. That's what this guy sort of, I think, showed us and taught us and crafted these characters out of this process of rehearsal, this rehearsal process.
Was the script as quiet as the movie ended up being in terms of the time you guys spent together?
What do you mean?
It's very quiet. There was literally no dialogue in the outline. It's a 50-page outline.
Yeah, I mean, it was quiet.
It's very specific, laid out scenes and beats mm-hmm. and moments, but there's no specific, like, he says this, she says that. So in the rehearsal process, we were just doing a lot of talking so that we didn't perfect and execute the moment in the rehearsal process, because if we did that, we'd sort of miss the point.
But
the whole point is to execute it on set.
I think what worked really well is it was just the three of us intensely for 2 weeks,
mm-hmm.
and we maintained that dynamic when we came to shoot it. So John, the way it worked was we would be able to move around the set as we wanted to,
mm-hmm.
and John had the task of following us. You know, it was completely led through the characters mm-hmm. and being as spontaneous and instinctive as possible.
So when the other actors came in, did they feel like a little like outsiders, or do they feel like...
I think everyone just really enjoyed doing it because it just gives you so much freedom. I think most actors love to work in that way.
Mm-hmm. And how was it for you?
It was kind of a mediocre experience overall. I wasn't too into it. I didn't understand what the improv was all about. I was like, what, there's no lines? I don't get it. What is this shit? It's only, the script's only 50 pages? Like, what is that? Yeah, I hated it.
Were you as driven as Felicity to do this?
I love this. I honestly, I read it. I think I got it from Drake, and I was getting on a plane that day, and I read it, like in an hour, and I called him. I was like, I'm in, I'm doing this. It was really, really good.
It was really fast.
Really, really good. And it just seemed like such a great opportunity. And I think Felicity said, improv, that's just like a dream. You do whatever, you go wherever, mm-hmm. you say whatever, or you don't say anything. And it's just really a fascinating way to create a character. It's challenging because you always want it to be that character. And you're informing it, but you want to make sure you're within the parameters of that person.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really cool. It's just really kind of fantastic universe. I've, from now on, do not do anything but improv. Like, even if there's a script, I just say whatever I want.
So you'll be improvising Star Trek 2?
Yeah, everything.
I'm not saying these lines.
I'm not saying anything. I will say whatever I want to say.
So is it? Do you feel it as it's happening on the set? I mean, do you feel like something beautiful is happening, or do you know, or is it just you're so in the moment it's not?
Well, you're completely unaware. I mean, the point you want to get to is where you're unaware that anyone's watching you.
Mm.
And that, I think we got to that point where you're immersed in what you're doing to such an extent that it just feels completely natural.
Yeah, you forget that there's this creep behind the monitor.
So does he prod you much at all on the set, or are you already prepared and once you're there, he's just kind of gently gliding you along.
Yeah, it's very gentle, like, just I feel like.
It's just like little.
Yeah, yeah, it's
points.
Really cool. Very good.
I mean, I
I'm
guess.
I'm actually being nice to Drake.
No, for once. It's been hell. They hate each other. They're just making an effort for this.
But we're brothers.
You're so shocked. You're so shocked that he's being nice to me. I love that. He couldn't believe it. He just really had to say it. And he interrupted his compliment, too, to say it. Love that. That's great. Well, fantastic.
Is there such thing as wrong? I mean, did you have a moment where you had to kind of like, oh, that's going the wrong way. I have to figure out how to take it back.
In that sense, yeah. But at the same time, the key to improv and the key to getting them to trust me through this process is that there is no wrong answer. Because at any time, if they feel like anything they're going to say might be wrong, they're going to sort of stifle themselves and they're going to be self-aware and conscious of what's happening. And it's important for them to lose themselves in the moment and just say whatever they say. I mean, we shot 60 hours of material, so, you know, 80% of what we shot is, you know, or even more, 90%. It's not even in the movie. Mm-hmm. So what's interesting about it is just kind of let it fly and then sort of guide it and then find the pieces in the editing room. I mean, so much of directing this movie was editing it, because choosing how to construct each scene was really a lot of the direction, I feel like.
So you're ready for the sequel already?
I'm ready.
That could be out next week.
Let's go.
Worldwide.
Yeah.
And when you fold in the other actors, is that, do you have to kind of prep them for where they're going, or are you just kind of trusting them? It's a very veteran cast.
Yeah, you know, I mean, they I think through the audition process, there was a lot of, like, rehearsing, actually, almost, just sort of mock rehearsing or mock shooting so that they, you know, put them through the paces so I knew what I would be getting on set. And they were great. Everybody's great. But I think that some of the actors, you know, a couple weeks after, like, people that came in only for 5 days, like Alex Kingston, for instance, she called me after a couple weeks and she's like, I hope it's okay. I have no idea what I did or said, but I hope it works. And then she was fascinated to see the final product. So
the two of them looked like they were having the best time in the world.
Oh, they did. They had an amazing time.
Yeah.
Except when you were living with the other guy, in which case.
I know, they didn't.
They weren't
approve.
So happy.
Yeah, that's great, that scene, I think.
Well, it's fascinating in a movie like this, when it's made like this, that you get those, so much of it is those little side looks and stuff that Drake actually caught. You know, it's not like you have a line of dialogue where one whispers to the other that clarifies it. You don't have any Basil exposition going on.
No.
They just, you know, very quiet little moments with them.
Yeah, that's what's interesting, I think, about it, is it's not a movie about exposition. It's a movie about emotion, and those feelings are very much so unsaid. And there's a lot of subtext, and there's a lot going on in the moment.
And Jennifer,
I want to pay you another compliment. Uh-oh. I'm like, I'm going to roll with the compliments right now.
You're going to try it out for a little while.
Yeah, I'll try it out for a bit.
See how
next interview, back to normal. Back to work.
We put you in the compliment Perfect. Seat, just yeah. so this would happen.
I just think those moments, like, I think one of the most interesting things on set is, like, yeah, you would have absolutely no awareness of what you were actually doing. But in a way, watching the movie, it's such, like, Drake, like, and Jonathan sat down when in editing, like, such an acute eye for detail, you know, for like picking out those tiny things that, yeah, we had not like any idea that were actually happening. And it's like really, really, you know, it's great.
You had a fantastic editor by the name of Jonathan Alberts who did an amazing job. The process. I put together an assembly that was 3 hours long to start with, and he came in and we started chipping away and got it down to 89 minutes, and it was amazing working with him.
So how long does it take to cut?
You know, this was a really fast project. When I got back from Sundance last year with Douchebag, got back in February, started writing this February, March, started prepping and casting in April and May, and we were shooting by June, and then we cut for 5 months, and here we are. So the editing process was only about 5 months.
Already in distribution.
Yeah.
Should this be the way people make movies more?
You know, to each his own. I mean, if it works for you, great. And for me, this works. So.
So did it just come to you as an idea of how to do things, or did you develop it over?
No, I grew up sort of in the improv world. My mother was a founding member of the Groundlings in Los Angeles, which is a famous improv sketch comedy group. And I grew up sort of studying and learning about improv. And so that just sort of found its way into filmmaking for me. So it's just the two are just kind of meshed together now.
Of course, you can do improv movies with it taking a lot longer than you'd take to do.
Yeah, no, totally. But there's something about feeling something and executing it now and finishing it now because you're in that mood. Mm-hmm. This movie was absolutely that. It was like, okay, this is what I'm thinking and feeling, so let's just try to get this done and get it done now, because 2 years from now or a year and a half from now, I'm not going to feel the same way about love or about this relationship, so it's important to get it done now.
So you're admitting this is your relationship?
Yeah, in a way. There's a lot of personal details in there. I think there's a lot of personal details in the movie from a lot of people. Yeah.
You're not wearing a wedding ring, though.
I'm not. I am actually a divorced human being. So.
Divorced from a Brit?
Divorced from another European country. Yeah.
A random European country that will go unnamed. So I'm sorry to hear that.
No, that's okay. Things make sure okay, you are. You know, it's a wonderful, wonderful relationship. I'm glad I had it.
Because it does have the ending of the unknown. It just kind of leaves you with who knows what's going to happen exactly.
Yeah.
But it's still hopeful though, I think. Mm-hmm. Which is important.
Apparently more hopeful than Drake.
Yeah.
I'm still hopeful. I'm still excited about the idea of love.
Well, we'll tour the rest of Europe and find you the next one.
Sounds good.
I'm taking Anton's job since he's not fucking good jobs anymore. Somebody
Someone has to do it.
So, the movie is so much about the ins and outs of the schedule of their lives, who's going to be where and who's going to be. How is that built into your shooting? I mean, are you shooting in anything like real time? Or are you just saying, okay, now you're in this country at this moment, and how do you get them there?
And we're shooting completely out of order because with the schedule we had to shoot certain locations out, so. Mm-hmm. There was absolutely a sense of we had to know where we were at all times, but they were amazing at just understanding the story and their characters and where they were at. I mean, very rarely was there ever a moment of what's going on or confusion. I mean, we just knew, and they knew. They were amazing together. I mean, the chemistry that they developed through the rehearsal process really made the shooting process really, really just, I mean, easy in a sense.
And the sex in the movie, which is, of course, a big theme of Sundance this year, but it's almost chased through the first act of the picture. Even after you guys have met, even as you started a relationship, there really aren't those kind of scenes until really midway through the picture. Sure. Is that a circumstance of what you shot or a circumstance of what you thought it should be? Was it a philosophical choice?
I think it's a sense of almost ugliness that you don't see Anna and Jacob in that way. Mm-hmm. There's a more innocence about them, but you see them with other people, and in that sense, it almost uglifies it, or, you know, make it, it's not, that's probably not a word, but it's certainly not a beautiful experience, I feel like.
Well, it's almost as though their relationship is based on those first few months when they're together, and they mythologize their own relationship. Mm. So it's as though there's something unreal about it anyway, in both their minds, because they're always trying to get back to that point when they first met. So in a sense, it suits that the sex would be too real. Mm-hmm. And there's a lack of reality about the way they perceive the relationship. They're trying to hang on to something which is probably gone.
Well, there was like a fundamental scene where Anna was in a chastity belt and Jacob was like, "Oh man, please take this off, please."
You have a combination
lock?
Take it
off. It was a full-on, it was like, it was insane.
She lost
the key. That scene will be on the DVD though.
Yeah, yeah.
The chastity belt scene.
I was always bummed that ended up on the cutting room floor.
It was so long, it was like 20 minutes.
I know, but it was great.
It's a tough log.
Yeah. It was very tough.
Only the tree succeeds.
But it is an interesting thing, taking sex out of the relationship. I mean, that's the, I guess, the easy go-to in a movie to, you know, create passion, quote-unquote, is that it's a sexual thing. But I guess that would actually take away from the movie thematically, because even though they have something that she says the line that she has something with him that she doesn't have with anybody else, part of that you think is a sexual relationship, but apparently not.
Well, it is, you just don't see it. You know?
Yeah.
I think you assume it, but that's not what it's about. They're really, as Felicity's...
So it seems to be a priority for both of them.
Yeah, later, as they get older.
Away from each other.
But for that, you know, the first love is not about that, you know? It's about something else. It's
that would
about
be a good detail, though. Yeah. Like, I have something to you that I don't have with anybody else, except for the sex.
Except for the sex.
Sex with other people is more great.
Yeah. It's actually a platonic relationship.
Yeah, totally.
It looks like you went on and picked two of the pretty blondes that you could find, male and female. For the two of them. To
yes,
be,
they're very beautiful blondes, Charlie and Jen.
It's the blonde theme. Is that intentional or just coincidence?
No, it's more just a vibe and a feeling of what kind of a performance it is. And I think Jen and Charlie do an amazing job at sort of capturing that grayness. It's not black and white. They're not exactly wrong for them, but they're not exactly right for them. There's a grayness there.
So brown on brown is the way to go.
Yeah, exactly. Well, in this movie, for sure.
And did you pick up Jennifer at Sundance? Did you?
I did. I picked her up in my pickup truck. I was rolling down the street, and I was like, Jen, come and do my movie. And she's like, sure. And she jumped in the back.
There's a movie about Uday Hussein, actually, where that happened 7 or 8 times with little girls.
Wow.
So it's a little creepy.
Yeah, yeah. I saw Winter's Bone last year at Sundance and fell in love with her and wanted her to play Sam. Absolutely.
So did you guys see the movie before Sundance?
We saw an early cut of it, but without the music.
Cool.
So
it's silent, actually.
Yeah, there was
no dialogue.
No dialogue whatsoever.
It was just pictures of you guys just not having sex.
Yeah.
Like a little flash book.
Yeah. It was like that. That's
not just like waiting for the sound.
So it seems a little insane, Drake, to show actors their stuff with a movie like this without any music.
Well, yeah. There's temp music in there, and a lot of the temp music.
It just wasn't finished.
Yeah, it wasn't like color corrected. And
yeah, the sound wasn't done. But you know, it was very important that they see the movie before this because I didn't want to scare them. Because I can imagine something as intimate as personal as this would be somewhat scary seeing it with 1,200 people first.
So they knew what you shot, but they didn't know what you kept.
I don't know. Did you guys even remember? Like, did you guys look at some of the scenes and be like, I don't remember saying that?
Yeah, you don't remember half of what you said. Because we just said so much. I mean,
this cup is like a reservoir. I mean, and
don't remember that.
So when you see yourself doing it, are you just like, how does that feel?
Well, what's nice about it, I think we were always interested in this line between the characters, who are the characters and how are we in relation to the characters, and you realize they've become something else. So I watch it and I see that it's your vision of them, actually.
Oh, wow. That's interesting.
That's a great way to put it.
And you suddenly, and then you can sort of cope with it because it's absolutely, it was so petrifying yesterday. But when you can make that, you have to sort of make that distance in a sense.
So how did you guys watch it? Did you watch it on DVD or did you watch it in the little screening room? Or?
VHS. Beta.
You gotta go out and find a beta.
That's all he has.
Oh, how quickly you said that, dude. That was awesome, VHS. So, I mean, yeah, of course he did. We got him a half inch.
So, but seriously, folks, did you like watch it on your home computer? Did you watch it on a TV?
You watched it with your mom?
Sit there by yourself?
Yeah, I watched it with my mom, actually. She,
really?
I did,
wow.
I did.
That's there.
Did you like it?
Yeah, she loved it. She actually watched it again after I was
done. Well, you were in the other room and you were like, okay, mom.
But she was watching and I was like, is she really fucking watching this thing again? No, she watched it. She loves it. And I loved it too. I was really, really happy. It's just difficult for you to watch yourself over.
I can't imagine.
It's not that pleasurable at all.
The performances are so naked in a way, and they're so vulnerable, and they're just so honest. And I can't even imagine like watching it after going through what we went through for that month and a half. I mean, it's really powerful stuff.
Are you guys both comfortable watching yourselves on camera in general, or is that uncomfortable anyway?
No, it's horrific.
Yeah, it's
completely. But it has to be done.
So someone's got to do it.
Yeah, it's got to be done.
So did you watch it by yourself or did you watch it with Epcot?
No, I watched it with Drake.
Yeah.
So funny.
Yeah, now that I think about it, I
watched it with Anton's mom and Anton. I just watched it with Drake.
I should have left the room.
He was just on my, like, just watching.
Sorry.
He was watching me. This is how much of a voyeur he is. He was watching me watch the film of myself that was his life. I mean, you can't get. Who is this man?
That sounds creepy. Oh, man.
And so did you, I guess you just kind of got what he was trying to show you, which was that you were going to be safe when you got here.
Yeah.
Well, that was always the hope, is to try to make them feel safe so that they could, I don't know.
So did you guys sit through the movie at the first screening?
Yes.
Yep.
And what was that like for you?
It was strange how people laughed so much. I don't think we expected.
Yeah.
It was, they laughed at the strangest points, which I don't think any of us expected. There was one really early one.
The things that were
early
really
on.
Serious.
Yeah. We were like, this is that big moment, and
like
you're laughing.
People,
The one where you say to Simon, you say, Simon, that's really nice after he proposes.
Yeah, that's it.
I got a huge laugh. Simon, that's really nice.
That's
it's like, what? I mean, I knew that. See, there's certain laughs. I mean, when you cut to Oliver and Alex, there's really funny, awkward moments. But that line specifically is very strange.
I think it should be funny.
Well, now it is.
Now it is.
Well, the whole signaling between you and mom also through that. You're kind of waiting to see what she says. And their relationship is actually beautifully developed without them saying much of anything to each other throughout the whole thing. So that whole scene is really kind of horrifying and funny. as you're going through it, because you actually don't mind that guy burning.
True, true, but it's also really sad because he's not a malicious guy. He just doesn't. He's just not quite with it.
He's just kind of boring for her.
Yes. He's not Jacob.
He's got her on lockdown.
Yeah, he's got her on
as he says.
Fitness
what?
Regime.
Yeah.
She's Simon
on lockdown.
Says.
Simon
says. Who is this guy?
He's so intense and she's so like into it. Yeah, she loves it. She loves the Simon regime.
And I recognized a lot of those moments in relationships that have come and gone 20 years ago for me. But they were, you know, long ago and those things of trying to reconnect and all those. Is that something that you guys... It just was there because you were having intimate, quiet moments that Drake got? Or were you processing all of that as you shot four times, five times as much as you actually ended up on screen? I mean, did you have to...
I think I just missed that question. I was just like...
Well, like that whole sequence where you guys are... as you guys try to keep on reconnecting over and over, is that something you just take from real life or are you just playing the moment?
I know, I just kept thinking... She was mad. I kept thinking they were. We just.
Yeah.
It was just this obsession with their relationship.
To get it back to, like you said, that fantasy world that where it was that goal. What's it called? There's a word for it. The period. The
nostalgia.
The golden age or something.
Halcyon.
Honeymoon.
No, halcyon's very British. I don't think anyone's.
That's the right word, isn't it?
No, like the peak, right?
That's right.
No, but what's...
Yes, yeah, see?
No, but
my friend says it's
no,
right.
No, there's like a... There's that... What is it called when,
salad
like...
The,
Salad days. There you go. That's what Martin Pitton would call it.
What?
The characters are constantly chasing that.
They're chasing
it doesn't exist anymore, for sure.
Yeah, and we talked about that a lot. They're just deluded.
They're mad.
Yeah.
They're, you know, in a sense, emotionally immature and growing through that and learning.
They're insane!
They're crazy people!
But can you survive that and have something... That's worth having, or you just don't know it because it's so crazy.
That's an interesting question. I think you don't know it, at least personally, especially in the movie. But you know, you have to go through it in order to grow and learn and have, you know, more mature relationships later in your life. So.
So you guys sat with the audience and you heard them laugh in funny places.
and good places too, for sure.
And did you feel the love? Did you feel people warming up? Did you just get a sense that everybody was with the movie from watching?
What did you think?
Yeah.
I think for the most part we've been overwhelmed by the critical response and by audience response, and then of course the sale, not even 24 hours after we premiered the movie, it's just been a whirlwind, and we feel really fortunate to have had a movie that we just poured our hearts into doing so well, and we're just so grateful.
You're getting really good at this. You're like,
it's amazing.
A douchebag.
I literally have not slept. We started negotiating at 11 o'clock and finished at 6 a.m. and then we just started doing this. So
did you guys get a wake up call? The movie's been sold. Wake up.
Yeah.
It's like winning an Academy Award nomination
or
something. Yeah,
it was pretty insane. It was completely unexpected because we made it. It was just between us really, and then.
Yeah. And now it's being shared with so many people.
I know.
What's so strange. It's almost like just giving away the baby. In a way, I kind of feel like a whore, but a good kind of whore. It's like, great, you know, Paramount wants to do this, let's do this, you know. It's very exciting.
And does the wave of love affect you guys a lot? Do you feel like now it's an achievement, now it's tangible? Or is it with the work you did on the stage that really mattered?
I think it's always just the time that you're doing it, and then this is just an incredible... bonus.
Yeah, I think it's that the work is the most important thing, and everything else, it's like, it's great and it's nice, but it comes and goes, you know. But like the actual experience is, it's that's the like spiritual part of it, you know, and everything else is just the material residue.
I think that was really kind of devastating. That was
nice.
Residue. I like that.
Yeah.
It, when we finished shooting, we did all the London stuff last, and we came back to the States from the UK, and we left Felicity in the UK, and we were just all depressed because it was just so, we were just so in a bubble, and it was so special that it wasn't really even about the end product. It was more just about the process of discovering these characters and discovering these moments. So I was devastated. It was awful finishing shooting. I just wanted to keep going.
You guys should get together like what's a week a year.
Let's
do
it.
A week together and just improvise.
We'll just shoot in
relationship.
Yeah, let's do it. See, we'll do like a Linklater thing. We'll do like Jacob and Anna 10 years later.
Yeah.
Every 10 years, we'll catch up with them and see where they're at.
People would buy that. People would like that idea actually.
Yeah, I think it's good.
That'd be great.
It'd probably be great for the actors. Too.
Webisodes.
Yeah, we'll do webisodes. That'll be perfect. Yeah.
And are either one of you careerists at all? Do you think about, you know, what you need to do this? And I mean, like I said, Felicity is, you know, part of the hot girl thing at Sundance this year. There's like a few of you coming up all the same time who seem to be kind of the promising next generation of actresses. Does that hype and that machinery affect you guys much at all?
I think as long as you are instinctive about your work and make the right choices for yourself and doing something like this, then you can keep your head in a crazy world.
And Anton, you're just gonna sell out?
Yeah, man.
He already did.
He doesn't care.
Franchises
yeah.
I saw it. I sell all the props from the movies I do. I'll autograph pictures for anything, sell them on eBay. I'll do it all.
So the chair for this will be on eBay, I'm
yeah,
sure,
totally.
Very soon.
His tie, wait. I'm taking his tie.
Wait, without embarrassing them, I genuinely believe that when the movie comes out, that the attention they will be getting just in general will be amazing. And as far as young actors that are in Hollywood right now that are working, there's nobody better than these two guys.
Well, you left them silent.
I zoned out. I missed what you said.
Perfect.